I request Professor Surendra Prasad sir to take over and address you.
Dr. Reddy, Professor Subudhi, Dr. Nasa, faculty members and principals of various educational institutions present here, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I'm extremely grateful to Dr. Reddy for inviting me for this important national seminar on quality in higher education. I consider quality as a very important subject for academicians and administrators to engage in from time to time, especially in a country like ours, where the education system has expanded enormously in the last 20 or 25 years. And where so much remains to be done on the quality front. In fact, this is a very good time to talk about these things because at this time, the national education policy is enjoying the center stage in the country, in the national discourse. And therefore, it's very pertinent to talk about this issue today. So I congratulate Dr. Reddy and his colleagues to have organized this seminar today. I'm going to be, going by the title of this workshop, I'm probably going to disappoint most of you today a little bit. The reason I'm saying that is, and I told this to Dr. Reddy, because I don't think there is much to talk about rankings, or NIRF rankings for that matter. The NIRF ranking parameters are in the public domain. You want better rankings, all you have to do is improve yourself in terms of those parameters. As far as I'm concerned, there's not much else to talk about it. So therefore, I will refrain from spending too much time on this, but fortunately, if you are still keen on having a lot of inputs on that, Dr. Nasa, who is now looking after NIRF almost single-handedly at this time, will definitely douse your curiosity to pure academic issues. And I think all of you are also academics, therefore, accreditation are not, rankings are not. All of us are genuinely interested in academic issues, which is what we are concerned with in our day-to-day life. So, because I believe that the main and central business of any academic institution will always be good academics. If you can continue to provide sound education to our students, whatever else we may or may not be able to do, we would have succeeded in a very significant way. I hope you agree with that basic philosophy. So what I'm going to do is share some fairly random thoughts on academic matters and perhaps raise a lot of questions that, in my opinion, need constant, frequent, and deeper thinking from all of us as much as we can. And in many cases, it may not be possible to provide good answers, at least not for everybody. No unique good answers may be there. There are no unique best answers, because the right answers will be different in different contexts and will have to be evolved collectively by the faculty concerned through collective application of mind. And again, I will focus only on two main aspects of academic life. And the first aspect is educational objectives, and the second aspect is curriculum development and pedagogy. I think these are things that are important to all academic institutions. There is an accreditation perspective to this about processes, where they will throw a whole lot of light, but I'm not necessarily going to focus on the accreditation aspect of it. I'm going to focus on the importance of this in specific context, and I think the context will become clear as I proceed further. I must also warn you that what I have to say about these issues may be pretty ordinary stuff, and most of it will be perhaps common sense. So don't expect some very great wisdom to flow out of my mouth in the next half an hour or so. It'll be fairly ordinary stuff that we all need to, we all probably know. But the biggest challenge, in fact, always lies in the most ordinary things we may be doing in our life. Since, in particular, in the context of academics, we get so thoroughly involved in the daily rut and routine of teaching and managing teaching that we sometimes forget to look deeply into what we do. So I shall briefly talk about these two aspects. Let me first start with some thoughts on educational objectives and goals. And to start the discussion, let me pose a question which perhaps may even be a stupid question in the context of this seminar and in the context of the fact that so many academic people are sitting here who are all educationists in some sense. And therefore, the stupid question in my opinion, which you may consider stupid, is what is the purpose of education, right? And if you were asked this question, you will perhaps laugh at it, but you will still try to give some answers to yourself and to me, perhaps, if I was to ask you this question. And suppose I ask you to answer this question in the broadest possible sense, right? At the broadest level, at least I would think that some of the broadest kind of answers to this question would be that one of the purposes of particularly undergraduate education is to recognize the fact that the students that you admit into your institution are in their teens, they're 16 or 17 year olds. And when they go out into the world, they are adults, right? At least age-wise. So the question is, are they going out as responsible adults? So one of the broadest objectives in some sense is to transform teenagers into adults. I don't think there is any difference of opinion on this issue. And in the process, we want them to become responsible citizens of the country. We also need to help them to grow wise, learn how they are, who they are, sorry, and perhaps search for a purpose in their lives and leave college as better human beings. Now that's it. That's fairly broad, but at the same time, very, very tall order in some sense. In my opinion, the incidental purpose of imparting knowledge so that they are useful to society in some domain. So knowledge dissemination, which is what accreditation is usually most about, is also very important. But for me, one of the primary objectives in education is to keep this broad goal also in mind. So if you look at these answers that I just talked about, transformation of teens to adults, helping them to grow wise, and search for a purpose in their lives, etc., etc., you'll find that there is a theme here which is common, there's an element here which is common to all these themes, and that is the development of wisdom, which is a crucial element. Now, Professor Sarasubuddha sitting there will simply disagree and say that I'm deliberately provoking him because he likes to be provoked. That wisdom is something that we can't even define, let alone measure, right? So how can we ever have these as educational objectives? Perhaps that's true, but I think let me also try to define wisdom at least in some sense. May not be in a measurable sense, but in some sense. One could say that it is the ability to investigate situations and experiences and carve out the right path for oneself and be of help to others in life. It is the ability to differentiate between the skillful and the unskillful, between the wholesome and the unwholesome, and be able to do so while making decisions in life, making choices in life, right? That ability to be able to do that is something that comes from your wisdom and not necessarily only from your knowledge. So wisdom also lies in learning to be useful to society in a meaningful way while developing an ethos of a happy and fulfilling life for oneself. Unfortunately, we are so focused on knowledge dissemination, in my opinion, we forget this larger mission, which is equally important, if not more. In fact, I would say, perhaps I will not be too wrong to say that wisdom is usually outside our range of vision these days. We do talk about the smartest person around, the wealthiest person around, the best looking person around, but I don't know whether we ever wonder about who's the wisest person around or wisest person of the year and so on and so forth. So the point I'm trying to make is, sure, we need to offer our students a good professional curriculum. We should teach them how to design long-lasting and safe bridges if they are engineering students. Develop drugs for healthcare if they are in biotechnology. Be adept at financial management if they are management students. And design rockets that explore the outer space. Surely we have to teach them all these things. They're very important. The knowledge dissemination part is extremely important. We could teach them history, quantum physics, art, literature, or what have you. But above all, we should try to teach them to think for themselves. Equally, we need to do all that is possible to facilitate development of wisdom and help them to manage relationships in a harmonious atmosphere. We may not always succeed, but that's what, as teachers, as college teachers, we must attempt. So every decision that we take as teachers, as administrators, as principals, these may be rules and regulations, playgrounds, or even perhaps a new canteen. The question we need to put in the front is, how do we add an educational value to it? So therefore, we too need to be wise. We need to be mindful ourselves that some things are more important, more wholesome than others, are more skillful than others in the context of handling these students. And also have a simple way for young persons to appreciate this difference. And therein lies the development of wisdom. So even if you agree with me all in all this, and perhaps there's not that much to disagree with it, at least in the, at a basic principle level, there remains the issue of how do we accomplish that development of wisdom in an educational institution, right? And again, there is no one way to do this. Each of us could work out ways which are suited for our own situation. To start with, a good peer group helps greatly. Institutions that provide a good peer group, bright set of young people for them to associate with, is the best thing they can do to start with. If in addition, you also provide a very liberal environment for all kinds of interaction amongst themselves and with the faculty, that's an additional help. In fact, a 24/7 interaction would be great, ideal, but that's only possible in residential campuses. May not be possible in day campuses. Because if you have such an environment, that environment empowers every student to educate every other student, to shape the lives of every other student as she shapes her own life. So whether residential or not, the fact is that these young people are going to stay in the institution for a significant period of their formative life, 3, 4, 5 years. And it's best to make use of their intelligence to help each other. That's very important. To develop, and that can go a long way in the development of the wisdom that I'm talking about. Because when you put so many bright young people together, as I said, they are all potentially agents of transformation for each other. They can shape others' personalities even as they shape their own, creating an enriching experience that they would later cherish for their lifetime. Because each of them brings different but very valuable life skill talents along with them. Of course, they have one common talent, the scholarly talent that brings them to the college in the first place with a share. But we have many other talents, and different people have different talents. So we need to provide them with an environment and ample opportunities to hone these talents further or learn new things that they were never exposed to before from their fellow peers. And if life is all about handling experiences, and I strongly believe that that's what it is, we need to provide them opportunities for experiential learning. Experiential learning in turn increases one's capacity to experience with greater sensitivity and is a key element for the development of wisdom. So although wisdom is an intuitive, innate quality of the human mind, it is possible to train the human mind to become wiser. All we have to do is to provide opportunities for students not only to try to understand the external world with a scientific temper and with reasoning, but also to explore the internal world using the same tools. So I'll say a little bit more about this element of wisdom in a more formal framework, but the first important thing that I would like us to realize is that while defining our educational objectives, there are a whole lot of educational objectives that you'll put there, particularly when you're writing your document for accreditation. But I would suggest is, what I would like to suggest is that we should not forget this larger purpose of education, this larger mission that goes beyond the rest of the curriculum, which is primarily knowledge dissemination and skills development. So that's the first point, the first message I'd like to present. Next, let me talk about curriculum and pedagogy. And again, let me start with a question like, what is an ideal curriculum? Again, I'm not going to go into the nitty-gritty of curriculum design for a specific, let's say, engineering area, anything like that. There'll be plenty of occasion to talk about that later in the day. So what can we say about an ideal curriculum? Now, whatever it is, it should go beyond being a rule book of requirements and regulations, because whenever we think of curriculum, what comes to mind is what is to be taught in first year, first semester, what is the sequence of courses that comes in the second semester, third semester, fourth semester, and there are rules and, you know, all kinds of things associated with this kind of input. That's important. But I think, again, one should look at the curriculum as something which is more than a rule book of requirements and regulations in that sense. It should be an expression of what a college truly believes education means, which is what I talked about a few minutes earlier. And as I said earlier, besides giving an in-depth knowledge of the subjects, it should have that larger purpose. And that larger purpose would require that students have adequate opportunity, and I'm again coming back to that wisdom factor, but slightly in a more formal framework now, to study the human condition through exposure to certain kinds of subjects which naturally build in a propensity to learn those things, human condition. And that's the subjects like humanities and social sciences. And be able to produce ethical responses to complex situations. So this is a very important point for, I believe most of you who are gathered here are from technical institutions, or perhaps engineering institutions or management institutions. But it doesn't matter what kind of curriculum you are trying to deliver to the students. They have to be simultaneously given inputs on the human condition. And the best way to do this is to engage them in subjects like literature, history, psychology, philosophy, and things like that. If you have that opportunity in your curriculum, then it provides a formal framework, because once you have subjects like these, students are forced to think about certain things that they otherwise won't think in their technical subjects. It's very important. So if you can do that well, it can constitute a formal vehicle for the wisdom factor referred to earlier. So one way of handling the wisdom factor is through a proper environment that I mentioned, a proper peer group. The second way is through inclusion of a good dose of humanities subjects delivered by or perhaps given by authentic persons who can engage students into these subjects. It's very important. Of course, that's one aspect of the curriculum which is related to the earlier wisdom factor that I mentioned. The other important aspect of the curriculum that we need to be aware of is that curriculum, particularly in the subject areas that you are engaged in, it's something that is extremely dynamic. Everything is, the knowledge expansion is happening so fast that we have to really run to stand in the same place if you want to keep track of it. So it's dynamic both in content and delivery. That means there should be a continuous review of its impact, what you are teaching today, whether it's impactful today. And if required, revision should be made as quickly as required. So constant revision is another important aspect of the curriculum. Unfortunately, in our country, I do not know how many of you belong to autonomous colleges and how many perhaps non-autonomous colleges. This may or may not be easy to do. But if you are in a position to do it, you should do it. Right? If you are not in a position to do it, you can't do very much about it. You can probably make a noise about it. That's about it. And that's what typically happens. But when we can, when you have the powers and the ability to revise a curriculum, it is helpful to do that as often as required. And while revising the curriculum, it's helpful to keep two principles in mind. And these are two principles that typically engineers use, so I'm mentioning them here. The first principle is understand what problem you're trying to solve through that revision before you actually design a solution for it, right? Because you should, as the Americans say, don't try to fix what ain't broken, right? Something that doesn't require fixing, you shouldn't touch it. And therefore, understand also what you want to fix. The second principle is don't try to change too many things at the same time. Because if you do that, it will never be possible for you to ascertain which cause led to which effect. So at least the causes and effects should be relatable in some way if you want to look at the impact of the changes that you... The next thing about curriculum that I like to speak about is what makes a curriculum purposeful. I said a few minutes ago that curriculum should be an expression of what the college believes to be the true purpose of education. Now, that's a very hard question, asking the college to make sure that the curriculum... Because first of all, it is very difficult to clearly state the purpose of college education, given so many different perceptions of different people. I would say different constituencies. And given the market forces at work, the students look at this in a particular way, the teachers look in a different way, the management looks in a third way, right? So there's so many constituencies which have different expectations. So two specific questions therefore become pertinent here. One is, should it respond to the desires of the students? For obviously, they will be looking at issues like jobs and placement. The curriculum that brings them good jobs, good salaries, good packages. Or should it respond to the preferences of the faculty? If you happen to come from an institution which has a slightly better research culture, the faculty will be much happier teaching research-centric courses and to research-centric students than undergraduate courses, basic undergraduate courses, right? So, and maybe other faculty members have slightly different ways of looking at it. Or should it correspond to the real needs of the society? So when you talk about purpose of college education, the perceptions change depending on who is looking at this question in this country. So how do we design a curriculum which is beneficial to all? Students, faculty,
and society? And in fact, is there such a curriculum? As I said, I'll be raising a lot of questions which will have different answers in my context and different answers in your institution's context, which we'll have to look at. I'm not providing, therefore, any specific answers. The second pertinent question in terms of purposeful curriculum is, should it be broad-based so that the students know a little of everything and something quite well? And that essentially means, should it offer a lot of choice? Or should there be a limit to this choice, indicating perhaps a greater clarity of purpose that you are trying to do for the students? And when you are doing a revision, you know, in an institution, typically, if I am an electrical engineer, I become a defender of the interests of the electrical engineers. If there is a physicist as part of the curriculum review committee, he would like to see much more physics in the curriculum. If there's a humanities person sitting there, he would like to see much more humanities there. So, in this day and age, you know, it's natural that so-called turf wars start. You know, I want more of electrical engineering there, somebody wants more of physics there, somebody wants more of chemistry there, and so on and so forth. But unfortunately, prioritization of one field over the other has become very difficult today, given the you know, huge number of choices that we might have. And one compromise solution that emerges usually is, all right, let's give the choice to the students. Let them choose what they want to learn, which is fine. So anyway, the second important message that I'm trying to give here is that purposeful curriculum is a multidimensional exercise that requires balancing the perceptions of teachers, students, and the society needs. We're talking about curriculum and pedagogy. One important issue that has become even more important these days in the context of a very large system of education that we are dealing with, and that is the issue of inclusion and diversity. Should our students be the ones the management would like to target? And management obviously would like to have a lot of students who can pay a lot of big fees so that their institutions are well off, right? So driven by their balance sheets, perhaps rankings, they may be interested in top ranks and other metrics. Or should it be the set of students who the professors most want to teach, are those whose education will most benefit society? That's the issue of inclusion and diversity that I'm talking about. Indeed, there was a time when college education was a privilege of the well-to-do or the elite. Today, it is a gateway by which the brightest and the most ambitious of the masses could rise in economic and social status. And rightly so. If I'm able, why should my background matter? I should get the same opportunity to get properly educated and rise up in life than any other student. So the extent of affirmative action becomes an important question. And it has become in our country, right? Whether we like it or not, some people don't like it. It's a criminal thing not to like it, because we have to take the entire society along when we are rising up, right? So affirmative action is very, very important. But having said that, a whole lot of issues result if you want to address it. The first important issue that results is the fact is that you have to handle very large classes. I mean, I remember when I joined the IIT system as a very young lecturer, I think the total intake of the IIT system was perhaps 250 students per year or 300 students per year. Right? Today, it's a system which handles 10,000 students. So the transformation is happening in front of our eyes, even in systems which are well protected in some sense. In other systems, it's even larger. So necessarily, you'll have to handle very large number of students, and we have to learn to deal with or handle such large classes and still keep, you know, handling means you can always go and lecture in a class like this, sitting thousands of students sitting in front of this. But An important thing is while you are doing that, you have to keep your educational goals intact. You must make sure that the learning happens. And that's not a trivially easy job. The second thing is when you have such a large class, there is bound to be a huge set of diversity of competencies. How do we handle the diversity of competencies? How do we handle the tensions and stresses that result from this diversity of competencies and these large classes? And in fact, there is an opportunity here. The opportunity is we can use a diversity of the class to enhance educational objectives. How to do that? As I said, I'll be only asking a lot of questions. The answers you have to find yourself. Right? So clearly, these aspects have bearing on the curriculum design and also on student welfare issues. Perhaps we don't look at it, and our accreditation framework also doesn't look at these things. And Professor Sahasrabuddhi is smiling at me, rightly so. So as a society, we have to gear up ourselves to address the needs of a diverse class. That's the next message I want to give. Ensure that each student has an opportunity to learn to the best, my apologies, to learn to the best of her ability. As the next point on curriculum and pedagogy, one aspect that is often ignored in most college education in India is the aspect of faculty-student contact and advising students, faculty advising of students. Now, I don't mean the contact in the classroom. That will happen anyway. I'm talking of contact outside the classroom, right? Because that plays as much an importance in learning and teaching framework as anything else. This is a very important aspect that is often ignored. And in this dimension of activity, the divide between faculty and student shows up most clearly. Now, this is difficult because advising students and young persons in general is a difficult job. And we need to recognize this in order not to lose patience. Because students at this stage, you know, they have rich academic opportunities in the college. But at this stage in their life, their talents and ambitions may not be clear even to themselves. And then on top of that, they have to cope with sometimes personal dilemmas, sometimes problems at home, sometimes problems in relationships that they wish to cultivate, and not easily separable from academic decisions. Many forces conspire to push students to feign and pretend confidence in study and career plans. They think they are doing fine, but the result is students tend to keep themselves busy in many activities simply to avoid the gnawing question, am I heading where I wish to go? And with endless distractions that are available today, it's easy to find excuses to look intensely anywhere but within oneself. Unfortunately, most of us as professors are ill-equipped to help students sort out their lives in these situations. Most of us possess little skills in such matters because we are not ultimately, you know, eventually we are not professional counselors. And that shows up in our engagement with the students, which is a little different from the ideal image that the students may have. Professors guiding the students with wisdom and skill. So although it is very difficult and very challenging, the fact is that it is not impossible to do something about it. And one useful skill on the part of faculty members that would help in the is the skill of listening. Because as teachers, we are so fond of, so enamored with one-way communication, talking and giving instructions, that the art of listening becomes a victim. I read a story some time ago about Mother Teresa. Someone asked her what she says when she prays to God. She replied, "I do not say anything, I just listen." The questioner persisted, "And what does God say to you as you listen?" She replied, "He does not say anything either, he just listens." The point I'm trying to make is listening is a very, very important way of engaging with students, and it's helpful. So in a nutshell, in the context of faculty student contact and advising, it's important that we encourage the faculty members to engage the students in discussions which help them to understand their own interests better, so that they can analyze themselves in terms of their ethical and moral behavior and learn to face and take responsibility for their decisions. Next, I'd like to say a few words, again, another important aspect of curriculum and pedagogy is about grading and evaluation. When I start a new class, a new course, start teaching in a classroom at the beginning of a semester, I tell my students very explicitly that I believe that grading is a necessary evil, and they should focus more on learning than getting top grades. And usually I tell them, if you have the learning goal, it automatically leads to better grades as a byproduct. And I must also admit, I mostly fail to convince them about the truth of what I'm telling them, because they feel that grades are everything. And perhaps they're right in some sense. So as far as I'm concerned, I feel that grading has many facets. Its main role, however, should be educational. In terms of rationales for grading, we can think of four distinguishable goals which are implied in grading. Each of them has an upside and a downside. There is first the work hard rationale. You know, you have to make students work hard and keep themselves out of trouble, because ultimately they have to pass out with some good grades, otherwise the employers will not even look at them, right? So they have to be out of trouble, and therefore it's a reasonable rationale. But the downside of this rationale could be that students may hate it, since often it makes them feel the work to be so pointless. And the result is, well, could be the cheating thrives. The second rationale could be excellence rationale. And that is to do the grading in such a manner which recognizes and rewards excellence, so that you get the very best on the best students. That's again a good objective. You want the good students to strive hard to do even better. But it also has some downsides. In a framework where you have a lot of electives, I like to choose electives where I know the teacher is a very lenient grader, right? That's a natural way of, so it strategizes course selection, fails to motivate the average student, and of course, in our heart of hearts, we know that in the ultimate analysis, your marks or GPA or whatever you like to call it is hardly a reliable measure of excellence. Many successful people who have been successful in life, they were probably very poor students in the class, right? And there are many stories that galore in this respect. The third aspect is the credentialing rationale. That is to rank students for those outside the university or outside the college. You know, after all, when employers come, they look at those students who have got top grades more seriously than those who have got less than top grades. But in my opinion, again, this is overrated by academics, because employers usually have additional yardsticks with which they look at potential employees than simply the grades. Grades are, of course, something that they use to filter, but not the only thing. And the fourth rationale, and the last rationale I'd like to talk about is the educational rationale, which in my opinion is the only rationale worth keeping in mind, not just to teach the A class students. So in summary, what I like to say here is, each rationale has a place, but the balancing act is important, because there are upsides and downsides. We ought to be cautious about emphasizing too much any one of these aspects, and except, of course, the educational rationale, which is very, very important. Before I conclude my address, I'd like to at least do some justice to the projected title of this seminar, and that has to do with outcomes, about which processes would they like to talk a little bit more about it. As I said, wisdom is perhaps not to be regarded as an outcome because you can't simply measure it. But there are learning outcomes that you can measure, right? So in the end, the success of the efforts in your teaching needs to be assessed on how well the students measure up to the benchmarks of the desired outcomes or attributes by the time they graduate. Because we aim to teach them to develop in all the four dimensions. They ought to have certain knowledge, certain skills, certain attitudes and behavior. And if I was to somehow be able to do that, I'd like to throw in wisdom also as a fifth dimension, but I don't know how to do that. So to what extent that is happening, to what extent the outcomes are actually being achieved. So while you are delivering your education, taking your exams, are you also looking at this aspect or not? That becomes important. So this requires that the faculty have an additional ability and willingness to carrying out outcome assessments and to modify the curriculum and modify the pedagogy when these are found to be deficient or wanting in some dimension or the other. This is very fashionable to talk about outcome-based education, outcome-based accreditation, and the basic principle of accreditation agencies, particularly NBA, is really this, outcome-based. But unfortunately, in spite of its importance and in spite of its usefulness, again, it's my observation, even for institutions which are duly accredited by NBA, that's usually ignored by most faculty and academic administrators. So most of it, many times, it's lip service than actual implementation. I can say this now because I'm no longer the chairman of NBA. But it cannot be overemphasized. It is very simple to understand, and it's not that difficult to do, but it's a little laborious, and at least initially. So therefore, in that sense, it is not easy to practice. But if you practice it well, it has the potential to be truly transformative in its impact and improving our education delivery. Finally, to conclude, I'd like to end by quoting from a couple of books that I read recently. I have a lot more free time now, so I read a lot many more books. And this is a set of books written by one Yuval Noah Harari. Is that name familiar to any of you? Anyone has heard of Harari? Or his two very important books that he has written recently? So some of you might have read this, his twin masterpieces, which he published in 2016. They are two big fat books. These are the titles of these books are Homo Sapiens and Homo Deus. If you have not read these books, I urge you to do so, all of you. I'm not being a salesman for the book, please, because I found them so instructive, so useful that I'm making this recommendation. Because between these two books, they present a panoramic view of the history of Homo sapiens and their projected future that is rarely available elsewhere. In fact, if I was a history teacher, I would teach history in the manner in which this book is written, not the way we normally learn history. Let me quote one specific passage from this book, which is a passage taken from the ending portion of his second book. You know, every part of the book is very logically argued, based on logical reasoning and actual facts coming from the domains of science and history. So let me quote. He says, "In the 21st century, the train of human progress is again pulling out of the station from where mankind stands today, that is where we are today. And this will be the last train to leave, ever to leave the station called Homo sapiens." Homo sapiens may not exist after that, in the form in which we know our our these things. Those who miss the train will never get a second chance. In order to get a seat on it, you need to understand 21st century technology, and in particular, the powers of biotechnology and computer algorithms. These powers are far more potent than steam and telegraph that usher in the industrial society. And they will not be used merely for the production of food, textiles, vehicles, and weapons. The main products of the 21st century will be bodies. He means human bodies. Brains, again, he means human brains. Whether they remain Homo sapiens or something else, that's not clear. And minds, that is human minds. And the gap, and he's not saying it, he's saying this after giving a lot of information about what's going on in science and technology today. It's based on a lot of reasoning. So the import of this you will realize only if you read the two books, just not by listening to my passage. So the main products of 21st century will be bodies, brains, and minds. And the gap between those who know how to engineer bodies and brains and minds and those who do not will be far bigger than any other gap witnessed so far in history. In the 21st century, those who ride the train of progress will acquire almost, and uses the word divine abilities of creation and destruction, like gods do, while those left behind will face extinction. Unquote. So this is something that I found very, very interesting and useful to contemplate, because it probably reflects not the total truth, but not far from the truth, particularly if you look at the reasoning that he gives. So in short, to conclude, the challenges that we'll face in a perhaps very short span of time are far greater than ever in the past. Are we as a society, are we as educationists, ensuring that our young people are up to these challenges? As educators, we are duty bound to understand these challenges and prepare the minds of the future generations to lead the human society in these circumstances. I can probably go on, but I must respect the timeline for my talk. I would be very happy if there is time for questions and you want to ask any questions on these topics or any other topic, perhaps even accreditation and ranking, if you wish. So these are a few random thoughts that I offer for your consideration. Please take what you find useful that may appeal to you and ignore others. Thank you very much.